Fighting the Flying Circus by Eddie V. Rickenbacker. Narrated by John Pruden. This unabridged audiobook was produced in the year 2012 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Introduction: The Making of an American Hero by Ian Cameron Martin. Of the many heroes of the First World War, few would attain the legendary status of Major Edward Vernon Rickenbacker, who returned home in 1918 as America's Ace of Aces and commander of the 94th Aero Hat in the Ring Squadron. Born October 8, 1890, to Swiss immigrant parents in Columbus, Ohio, Eddie learned from an early age the value of self-determination and hard work. When his father died in 1904, Eddie was only 13 years old. He later wrote of the event, "I didn't have to be told what we were up against. The day after my father's funeral, I didn't go to school. I went to work. The night he passed, I changed from a boy to a man." Lying about his age, Eddie began working night shifts at a glass factory, then at a steel foundry. Soon he found his way to Evan's garage and learned to repair cars. By age 19, Eddie was racing professionally against some of the best drivers in the sport, and in 1914, he set a world speed record of 134 miles per hour driving a Blinson Benz over the sands of Daytona Beach. His life, it seemed, was destined to be one of daring and fame. As the rest of the Western world plunged into the abyss of the First World War that year, the United States remained neutral. The European war seemed far removed from Eddie's racing career. His skill behind the wheel was earning him $34,000 a year, a tremendous sum in those days. In the late summer of 1916, Eddie made a risky journey through U-boat-infested seas to England with the goal of developing a British car for American races. What he discovered was a nation totally committed to the life-or-death conflict with Germany. All of England's industries were producing weapons and materiel for the war effort. From his hotel window near the Brooklyn Speedway, watching Royal Air Force fighters taking off and landing, Eddie became fascinated with air combat. He would return to the United States in early 1917, convinced that the nation should enter the war against Germany, and with a burning desire to serve his country as a fighter pilot. In 1917, American aviation was in its infancy. Although a small number of Americans had volunteered to fly with the French Escadrille Lafayette, the United States was wholly unprepared for war in the skies. The Army Air Service began the war with 35 pilots and 51 student pilots on its rosters. Most of its officers were drawn from Ivy League candidates. Eddie volunteered for the Army when war was declared in April. By the end of June, he arrived in France as a Sergeant First Class, assigned as a driver in General Pershing's command staff. Determined to be a pilot, his opportunity arose through a chance encounter with Colonel William Billy Mitchell, who commanded the Army's Air Service. The colonel's car had broken down, and Eddie flipped open the hood to perform a quick repair. Seizing the moment, he asked Mitchell if he could transfer to the Air Service. A few days later, he received orders to take a physical and proceed to pilot training. In those simpler times, 17 days of training and 25 hours in the air earned Rickenbacker his pilot's wings and a commission as a first lieutenant in the U.S. Army Signal Corps. Assigned to a training airfield at Issoudun as engineering officer, he faced new obstacles to attaining a combat assignment due to his lack of formal education. As with all other challenges in his lifetime, Eddie would not be denied. He cajoled his superior officer until he earned permission to join the first All-American Flying Unit, the 94th Aero Hat in the Ring Squadron, based at Villeneuve. To his great fortune, he then fell under the tutelage of a living legend, Major Gervais Raoul Lefberry, a French-American ace with 17 victories who had transferred from the Escadrille Lafayette to the American Air Service. Lefberry, in the last few weeks before his death in combat on May 19, would lead the fledgling American pilots on their first missions and impart to them the rules of aerial warfare that would keep Rickenbacker alive for the remaining months of the war. It was at this critical juncture that Rickenbacker began narrating his incredible memoir, Fighting the Flying Circus. Entering combat in March 1918, Rickenbacker blazed a trail across the skies over France, achieving 26 confirmed kills over German aircraft by the end of hostilities on November 11, 1918. Along the way, he quickly attained the rank of major, and proving to be a natural leader of fighting men, ended the war as the commanding officer of the 94th Aero Squadron and a national hero. At a time when the average life expectancy of novice pilots was measured in weeks, Rickenbacker achieved the most important victory of all, surviving to tell the tale. 12 years later, on November 6, 1930, President Herbert Hoover awarded Rickenbacker with the Congressional Medal of Honor at Bowling Field, Washington, D.C. Of his early success in life, Rickenbacker would later write, "Procedures do not make the man. Only the man himself can make himself what he is by taking full advantage of the excellent raw material supplied to him by God." Rickenbacker's memoir stands as one of the best accounts of flying from the Great War and a testament to the courage of the early air service pilots. It is a brutally honest account of men at the dawn of the age of flight in machines of canvas and wood whose survival depended solely on their own skill and daring. Rickenbacker would go on in life to even greater achievements, owning the Indianapolis Speedway, founding Eastern Airlines, and serving as an emissary to the Soviet Union in World War II. He would even survive an epic plane crash and 24 days adrift in a life raft on the Pacific in October 1942, inspiring a new book, Seven Came Through. Yet it was for his fame as America's ace of aces that the nation remembered him best. In my view, Eddie never surpassed the iconic snapshot from May 1918, standing next to his Newport fighter emblazoned with the hat and the ring markings of the 94th Aero, with the big smile and casual air, the assuredness and confidence of a youth with all his life before him. True greatness, however, came from his selfless devotion to country. Looking back on his life in 1967, he reflected, "It is not old-fashioned to wave and love the flag of our country or to worship God in heaven. Let us acknowledge and be grateful for the blessings of freedom that God has given us. Let us dedicate our lives to the perpetuation of the American principles of freedom with confidence. Let us stop and analyze ourselves to find out what life means to us. Let us therefore pray every night for the strength and guidance to inspire in others the gratitude, the love, the dedication that we owe our beloved country for the sake of our posterity. Then, and only then, can we say when the candle of life burns low, 'Thank God, I have given my best to the land that has given so much to me.'" Chapter 1. Introducing Archy. After days of schooling and nights of anticipation, I woke up one morning to find my dreams come true. Major Raoul Lefberry, the most famous of our American flyers and the commanding officer of our group, announced that a flight would take off after breakfast for a look at the war across the German lines. He himself was to lead the flight. The patrol was to be over enemy territory in the Champagne sector. Who was to go was the thought in every pilot's mind, as we all stood by in more or less unconcealed eagerness. None of us had as yet caught a glimpse of our future arenas. We all had vague ideas of the several kinds of surprises in store for us over Hun lines, and every one of us was keen to get into it. Major Lefberry looked us over without saying much. Leff was very quiet in manner and very droll when he wanted to be. He had seen almost 4 years of service with the French Air Service and in the Lafayette Escadrille, and had shot down 17 Hun aeroplanes before the American Air Service began active work at the front. Every one of us idolized Lefberry. "Rick," said the major casually, "you and Campbell be ready to leave at 8:15. I tried to appear nonchalant as I replied, "Yes, sir." Douglas Campbell put up a much better face than I did. The other boys crowded around and presented us with good advice such as, "Look out for Archy, mind," and one thoughtful fellow kindly cautioned me to crash in our lines if the Huns got me so that he could personally put a cross over my grave. That memorable morning was the 6th day of March, 1918. I had joined the Hat in the Ring Squadron just 2 days before at Villeneuve. We were then some 20 miles behind the lines and were well installed in an old aerodrome that had been used previously by several French aero squadrons. This expedition was to be the first essay over the lines by a made-in-America squadron. Sharp upon 8 o'clock, I walked into the 94th Squadron hangar and called my mechanics. We were flying the French single-seater Newport with a rotary motor, and every machine was kept in the pink of condition at all times. Nevertheless, I wanted to make doubly sure that everything was right on this occasion, or Major Lefberry had a reputation for punctuality. "Henry," I demanded, "how is my number one?" "Best machine in the shop, sir," the mechanic replied. "She's been all tuned up since you came in last night, and there's not a scratch on her."
"There will be when you see her again," I muttered. "Run her out on the field and warm her up."
I left the hangar and looked down the road for the major. Campbell was already in his flying clothes. I wanted to be ready on the exact minute, but not too soon. So I lit a cigarette and kept an eye on the major's door. All the boys came sauntering up, trying to look as though they were not half mad with envy over my chance to get my head blown off first. They wished me well, they said, but they would like to know what to do with my personal effects. When Major Lefberry entered the hangar, he found us ready for him. It takes about 10 seconds to step into your teddy bear suit, slip a flying helmet over your head, and snap on the glasses. Campbell and I climbed into our Newports. The Major gave a few instructions to Lieutenant Campbell, then came over to me. I felt like a man in the chair when the dentist approaches. Of course, I listened politely to his parting words, but the only thing that appealed to me in his discourse was the order to stick close to him and keep formation. He did not have to repeat that order. Never before did I realize how seductively cold death beckons a pilot towards his first trip over enemy lines. Lefberry ran up his motor for a moment, then took off. Campbell followed on his heels, and then I opened up my throttle. I cast a last, longing glance at the familiar flying field as I felt my tail go up. The wheels began to skim the ground, and with the wind in my teeth, I pulled her up and headed after Campbell. What a devil of a hurry they were in! I knew I should never catch up with them. The beautiful ruins of Reims soon spread beneath my right wing. My machine was certainly not as fast as either Lefberry's or Campbell's. I continued to hang back far behind my formation. The lines of the enemy were approaching, and Lefberry, my only salvation as it appeared to me, was at least a mile ahead of me. I shall believe to my dying day that Major Lefberry knew my thoughts at that moment. For just as I felt that he had forgotten all about me, he suddenly made a virage and took up a position a few hundred feet from me, as much to say, "Don't worry, my boy, I have an eye on you." Again and again this occurred. It was with great difficulty that I tried to perform the same maneuvers that Major Lefberry executed with such great ease. I grew somewhat interested with my attempts to imitate his example in preserving our little flight formation, and this occupation of keeping within shouting distance of my companions made me forget entirely that old Mother Earth was some 15,000 feet underneath me, and the trenches about the same distance ahead. The bitter, numbing cold which always prevails at these high altitudes was, of course, by this time an old and familiar experience to me. We had been sailing along at this dizzy height for some 30 minutes between Reims and the Argonne Woods when it occurred to me to look below at the landscape, and such a spectacle spread itself out before my eyes when I at last did look out over the side of my little office. The trenches in this sector were quite old and had remained in practically the same position for 3 years of warfare. To my inexperienced view, there appeared to be nothing below me but old battered trenches, trench works, and billions of shell holes which had dug up the whole surface of the earth for 4 or 5 miles on either side of me. Not a tree, not a fence, no sign of a familiar occupation of mankind. Nothing but a chaos of ruin and desolation. The awfulness of the thing was truly appalling. Perhaps this feeling got the best of me for a moment. I don't know of what Campbell was thinking, and I suppose Major Lefberry was far too accustomed to the situation to give a thought to it. But just when I had gained enough equilibrium of mind to keep my place in formation and at the same time take an interest in the battlefields below me, I began to feel a terrible realization that seasickness had overcome me. A stiff wind was blowing all this time, and no ship upon the high seas ever rolled and pitched more than my baby Newport did this 15,000 feet above no man's land, while I was attempting to follow Major Lefberry's evolutions and maneuvers. I didn't want to confess even to myself that I could get sick in the air. This was what would be expected from a brand new aviator on his first trip over the lines. It would be wonderfully amusing to Lefberry and the rest of the boys in the squadron when I got back to the field, if I ever did, to advise me to take along a bottle of medicine next time I tried to fly. I grew cold with the thought of it. Then I set my teeth and prayed that I might fight it off. I determined to look straight ahead and fly straight ahead,
and to concentrate my whole mind on the task of sticking it out, no matter how I felt. I hardly got control of myself when I was horribly startled by an explosion which seemed only a few feet in my rear. I didn't even have time to look around, for at the same instant the concussion caught my plane, and I began to roll and toss much worse than I had ever realized was possible. The very terror of my situation drove away all thoughts of sickness. In the midst of it, several more shocks tipped my machine and repeated sounds of nearby explosions smote my ears. No matter what happened, I must look around to see what awful fate was overtaking me. All that I could see were four or five black puffs of smoke some distance behind and below my tail. I knew what they were right enough. They were Archy. They were 18-pound shells of shrapnel which were being fired at me by the Germans. And the battery which was firing them was only too well known to me. We had all been told about the most accurate battery that Allied aviators had met in this sector. It was situated just outside of the town of Sweep, and there was Sweep down there just under my left wing, a mile north of Sweep as the exact location of this famous shooting battery. I looked down and picked it out quite clearly, and I knew they could see me and were seeing me much more plainly than I was seeing them. And probably they had quite a few more of those shells on hand which they were contemplating popping up at me. I shall never forget how scared I was and how enraged I felt at the old pilots at home who pretended to like the Archies. The latter were bursting all around me again and were terribly close, and I felt a vengeful desire to get home just once more in order to take it out on those blasé pilots who had been telling us newcomers that anti-aircraft guns were a joke and never did any damage. They used to count up the cost of each shell at $5 or $10 apiece and then figured that they had cost the German government about $1 million for their morning's amusement in flying over the Archy batteries, with never a hit, and I had been fool enough to believe them. Any one of those shells might happen to hit me just as well as happen to burst 100 yards away. It was due entirely to my own good luck, and not at all to those scoffers' silly advice that one of them hadn't hit me already. I was more indignant with the boys who had been stuffing me with their criminal wit than I was with the Boche gunners who were firing at me. Never before did I, and never again will I, quite so much appreciate the comfort of having a friend near at hand. I suddenly noticed that Major Lefberry was alongside me. Almost subconsciously, I followed his maneuvers, and gradually I began to realize that each maneuver he made was a direct word of encouragement to me. His machine seemed to speak to me, to soothe my feelings, to prove to me that there was no danger so long as I followed its wise leadership. Little by little, my alarm passed away. I began to watch the course of the black puffs behind me. I grew accustomed to the momentary disturbance of the air after each explosion, and almost mechanically I met the lift of the machine with the gentle pressure of my joystick, which righted my Newport and smoothed its course. And a rush of happiness came over me with the assurance that I was neither going to be sick, nor was I any longer in any terror of the bursting shells. By Jove, I had passed through the ordeal. A feeling of elation possessed me as I realized that my long-dreamed and long-dreaded novitiate was over. At last, I knew clear deep down in my own heart that I was all right. I could fly. I could go over enemy lines like the other boys who had seemed so wonderful to me. I forgot entirely my recent fear and terror. Only a deep feeling of satisfaction and gratitude remained that warmed me and delighted me. For not until that moment had I dared to hope that I possessed all the requisite characteristics for a successful war pilot. Though I had feared no enemy, yet I had feared that I myself might be lacking. This feeling of self-confidence that this first hour over the Sweep battery brought to me is perhaps the most precious memory of my life. For with the sudden banishment of that first mortal fear that had so possessed me, came a belief in my own powers that knew no bounds. I loved flying. I had been familiar with motors all my life. Sports of every sort had always appealed to me. The excitement of automobile racing did not compare with what I knew must come with aeroplane fighting in France. The pleasure of shooting down another man was no more attractive to me than the chance of being shot down myself. The whole business of war was ugly to me. But the thought of pitting my experience and confidence against that of German aviators and beating them at their own boasted prowess in air combats had fascinated me. I did not forget my inexperience in shooting, but I knew that could be learned easily enough. What I hungered to ascertain was my ability to withstand the cruelties and horrors of war. If that could be conquered, I knew I could hold my own with any man who ever piloted an aeroplane. This confidence in myself must have aided me considerably in my learning to fly. After 12 flights in a machine in France, I went aloft for a flight alone. After that first solo flight, I tried several different types of machines with never any feeling of insecurity. I was floating along through enemy skies in ecstatic contemplation of these thoughts when I suddenly discovered that Major Lefberry was leading us homewards. I glanced at the clock on my dashboard. It was nearly 10 o'clock. We had been out almost 2 hours, and our fuel supply must be running low. These fast-flying fighting machines cannot carry a large supply of gasoline and oil, as every pound of weight counts against the speed and climbing powers of the aeroplane. Gradually, we descended as we approached the vicinity of our aerodrome. This lovely section of France, as yet undevastated by war, spread below the wings of our little Newports in peaceful contrast to the ugliness that lay behind us. Some snow still filled the hollows as far as the eye could reach, for a severe storm had raged over this section of the country but a few days before. We circled once about the field and, shutting off motor, slid gently down into the mud, which quickly brought the machines to a full pause. Quickening the speed of the propellers, we taxied one by one towards the door of the hangar, before which every pilot and mechanic stood awaiting us with open-armed expectancy. They were eager to hear the details of our first flight into enemy territory and to see how two beginners like themselves had stood the experience. Both Campbell and I wore satisfactory countenances of bored indifference. We had had a little flip around over the Hun batteries, and it had been most droll seeing the gunners wasting their ammunition. We must have cost the Kaiser a year's income by our little jaunt into his lines. As for enemy aeroplanes, none of them dared to venture up against us. Not a plane was in our vicinity. Just here, Major Lefberry broke into the conversation and asked us particularly what we had seen. I didn't like the sound of his customary little chuckle on this occasion, but we both repeated as easily as we could that we hadn't seen any other aeroplanes in the sky. "Just what I expected. They are all the same," was the Major's only comment. We indignantly asked him what he meant by addressing two expert war pilots in such tones. "Well," said Lefberry, "one formation of five SPADs crossed under us before we passed the lines, and another flight of five SPADs went by about 15 minutes later, and you didn't see them, although neither one of them was more than 500 yards away. It was just as well that they were not Bosches. Then there were four German Albatrosses 2 miles ahead of us when we turned back, and there was another enemy two-seater nearer us than that at about 5,000 feet above the lines. You ought to look out a bit when you get in enemy lines." Campbell and I stood aghast, looking at each other. Then I saw he was thinking the same thoughts as I. The Major was ragging us from a sense of duty to take some of the conceit out of us. But it was only after weeks of experience over the front that we realized how true his statements probably were. No matter how good a flyer the scout may be, and no matter how perfect his eyesight is, he must learn to see before he can distinguish objects either on the ground or in the air. What is called vision of the air can come only from experience, and no pilot ever has it upon his first arrival at the front. Then, sauntering over to my machine, the Major bucked me up very considerably by blandly inquiring, "How much of that shrapnel did you get, Rick?" I couldn't help laughing at his effort to put me in a heroic picture frame for the benefit of the boys who were listening. Imagine my horror when he began interestedly poking his finger in one shrapnel hole in the tail. Another fragment had gone through the outer edge of the wing, and a third had passed directly through both wings, not a foot from my body. The boys told me afterwards that I stayed pale for a good 30 minutes, and I believe them, for a week passed before the Major suggested to me that I again accompany him into the German lines. Chapter 2. The Aerodrome. I often wondered whether the mothers and friends of our pilots formed a true conception back home of the surroundings and daily doings of their loved ones in France. Even the term aerodrome, where it is known aeroplanes are landed and kept and cared for, and where the pilots live and start from in their trips over the lines, and where they are anxiously awaited at the end of their patrol by their comrades. Even Aerodrome must convey a more or less uncertain picture to those who have never actually seen one. Picture in your minds a smooth field covered with sod and occupying a situation near a town and good highway. It is on comparatively level ground and is square in shape, and each of the four sides is about half a mile in length. Such a field accommodates very nicely four squadrons of fighting machines, which means 80 or 90 aeroplanes and as many pilots. The road skirts one side of the square. Close to the road, on each corner of the square, are placed two large sheds or hangars to house the aeroplanes. Each hangar will hold comfortably 10 or 12 machines of the small type. There, they spend the night, and each machine is carefully inspected by the mechanics who belong to it. Each pilot has three mechanics who are responsible for his aeroplane, and it is seldom that any defect can escape their jealous attention. Around the edges of the field, then, these 8 or 10 large hangars stand facing inwards, with wide open doors through which the aeroplanes can pass onto the ground. A short distance away, the mess and sleeping quarters for the officers and each squadron are situated. As there are but 20 pilots to each squadron, the officers of two squadrons frequently mess together. The enlisted men, including the mechanics, truck drivers, workmen, and servants, occupy quarters of their own at a little distance behind the hangars. As each squadron requires almost 200 enlisted men to take proper care of its many details, it is seen that the entire personnel of the average aerodrome group numbers quite 1,000 men when the headquarters, searchlight company, telephone squad, lighting plant, Red Cross, and YMCA personnel are added to it. The anti-aircraft gunners who have charge of the defense of the aerodrome against enemy raids are not attached to the air service and are not properly part of the aerodrome membership. Such, then, is the rough arrangement of the pilot's aerodrome. From the sky, an aerodrome can be seen many miles away by an experienced observer, and although every effort is made to camouflage the hangars, huts, and aeroplanes, no flying fields can long be in use by either side before they are discovered by the enemy. We were but 3 weeks in the Villeneuve aerodrome, and during that time the weather was so severe that comparatively little flying was undertaken by the first of our American pilots who formed this unit. March 1918 had snowstorms, heavy rains, and high winds. Our aeroplanes were not of the best, and they had not yet been fully equipped. An amusing episode occurred in this connection, which seems funnier now than it did at the time. The French authorities very kindly made arrangements to help train the new pilots of our squadron in combat fighting over the lines. Accordingly, every day or two, an experienced French airman would drop down upon our field and take away with him two of our inexperienced freshmen for a trip into Germany, just as Major Lefberry had taken Campbell and myself. Naturally, all of our pilots were anxious to go. After 2 weeks patrolling over enemy territory in this manner, you can imagine the consternation of these French flight leaders when they discovered that the American machines which had accompanied them carried no aeroplane guns. Our machine guns had not yet arrived.
Fortunately, the Boches didn't know it, and no encounters had taken place. But the idea of this dummy fleet carrying on such a gigantic bluff over enemy lines was as comic to us as was the story of the wooden ships of the British Navy which had deterred the German fleet from leaving the harbor. The Frenchmen, however, couldn't understand this sense of humor.
It was at this period that we lost one of my dearest friends and a commander who was respected and loved by all the pilots. Captain James Miller had left family and home and a prosperous business in New York to serve his country over the battlefields of France. He was a light-hearted, lovable companion, but I had long ago discovered the stern, determined qualities of his character. He had often told me his greatest desire was to go into the skies and win a combat against an enemy aviator. The long delays in Paris irritated him, and his work in organizing the aviation school at Issoudun for the training of American pilots did not satisfy him. He burned for an opportunity to get over the lines in a fighting plane. I found Captain Miller at the Villeneuve Aerodrome when I arrived there on March 4, 1918. He had command of the fighting squadron adjoining mine, the 95th. But he had no machines and no equipment, and apparently he was as remote from air combats there as he had been in Paris. Still dominated with the one idea of getting into a fight with the enemy, it was especially difficult for him to be patient. One day, towards the middle of March, we received a visit from Major Johnson and Major Harmon, who were then temporarily attached to one of the French SPAD squadrons in the vicinity. I shall never forget the boyish delight with which Captain Miller came to me after their departure and confided to me what he considered the most cherished secret in his life. Major Davenport Johnson had promised him that he might call at his aerodrome the following day and take a flight over the lines in one of their machines. He was ecstatically happy over the prospect. I never saw him again. The following evening, we were notified through military channels that Captain James Miller was missing. Not until several days later did I learn the details of his disappearance. Then I learned that Major Johnson himself had accompanied Miller on his first flight, and that they had passed over Reims and proceeded towards the Argonne Forest, the very same patrol on which Lefberry had taken me but a few days before. Two squadrons of enemy machines were discovered some distance within the enemy lines, and Miller, not observing them, flew in and was attacked. The enemy aeroplanes were two-seaters, carrying machine guns in front and behind. Major Johnson did not warn Miller, but returned to his field and landed, stating that his guns had jammed. Captain Miller was never seen again. A month later, a German official report reached us that Captain James Miller of the American Air Service had been wounded in combat and had fallen within German territory, where he died a few hours later. Poor Jim. His was the first and most sorrowful loss that had come to our new group. Then it was I learned that I must not permit myself to cherish friendships with my pilot comrades so intimately that their going would upset the work I had to do. For every aviator's day's work included the same risks that had cost Jim Miller his life. If one permitted constant anxiety for friends to weigh down one's spirits, one could not long continue work at the front. These days of March 1918 were trying ones for our allies in the British and French armies. It was known that the enemy was preparing for a conclusive and tremendous push within a few days, with which to gain the Channel ports against the British before the troops from the United States could be in position to aid them. The Germans knew better than our own countrymen at home knew just how difficult would be our preparations for a really important force of aeroplanes. They had seen the spring months pass, and instead of viewing with alarm the huge fleet of 20,000 aeroplanes sweeping the skies clear of German Fokkers, they had complacently witnessed the Fokkers occupying the air back of our lines whenever they desired it, with never an American plane to oppose them. On March 21, 1918, the great German attack was launched against the British in the north. We heard serious rumors about the numbers of prisoners captured by the Huns and the rapid advances they were making in each push. Our aerodrome at Villeneuve was at that time but 18 miles from the lines. In clear weather, we could distinctly see our line of observation balloons, which stretched along the front between us and the lines. The booming of guns sounded continuously in our ears. On March 30th, we were ordered to move our squadrons to another aerodrome farther away from the front. We went to APA that day, where we found ourselves about 30 miles from the lines, and still with no machines with which we might hope to stem the alarming advance of the enemy. Here at APA, the 84th Squadron was joined by Captain James Norman Hall, the author of Kitchener's Mob and High Adventure, also Captain David McKay Peterson of Hansdale, Pennsylvania. Both of them were experienced pilots who had become celebrated for their air work in the Escadrille Lafayette and who did much to enhearten us and instruct us during this forlorn period. We had all heard of these boys and idolized them before we had seen them. I cannot adequately describe the inspiration we all received from the coming of these two veteran air fighters to our camp. A day or two after we had settled down in our new aerodrome, we heard the buzzing of an approaching machine. All hands rushed out to see what it meant. A Newport bearing American colors assured us it was a friend and probably another new member of our squadron, since he was preparing to land on our field. He shut off his motor and glided down until his wheels skimmed the ground. The next instant, her nose struck the mud, and in a twinkling, the machine had somersaulted over onto her back and slid along towards us, tail foremost. We walked out to the wreck to secure the remains of the raw pilot who hadn't learned yet how to land a machine, and some of us made rather caustic comments about the authorities sending us such unsophisticated aviators. Imagine our stupefaction when we discovered the grinning face of Captain Hall himself looking at us upside down. Fortunately, he wasn't hurt in the slightest, and I think he would be glad if he could know how much good it did all of us young pilots to discover that even the best airmen can sometimes come a cropper. Captain Hall climbed out of his wreckage and, coming over to me, told me there was another machine still at our old aerodrome which must be flown over. I was directed to get a motor car and drive back to Villeneuve, and after making certain that everything was in order with the Newport, fly home with it on the morrow. I accordingly got myself ready and set out. It was late at night when we started. Shortly before midnight, we entered a small village just south of Chalons on the Marne River. Suddenly, we noticed people running excitedly about the streets, and as they came under the glare of my headlights, I saw they were absolutely stricken with terror. I stopped the car as an old man came running up to me and asked him what was the trouble. "The Boches are overhead," was his reply, pointing upwards into the night. "Please, monsieur, put out the lights of your car." I snapped out the headlights and stood there for a moment, watching those poor people scurrying about for shelter. Old women whose backs were bent with age and toil were running helter-skelter through the streets for the open country, small children clinging to their skirts. They did not know where they were going, and many of them ran into each other as they crossed to and fro. Their one idea was to get away from their beds, where they imagined the bombs from the Hun aeroplanes would be certain to find them. In truth, that would have been the safest place for them to remain. We proceeded through the village, and a moment later came to a rise in the ground from which we could see the anti-aircraft shells bursting above the city of Chalons a few miles ahead of us. Many sweeping searchlights were searching the heavens with yellow fingers itching to grasp the path where the enemy planes were pursuing their way. For almost an hour we stood on this hill and regarded the spectacle with the same critical interest we had often experienced in watching an opera. Then suddenly the lights were extinguished, and the booming of exploding shells ceased. We regretfully climbed back into our car and continued on our way. The show was over. It took us an hour to wake up the landlady in the best hotel in Chalons that night. When we finally found the night bell and kept a resolute finger upon the button until the storage battery threatened to become exhausted, the good woman appeared in negligee and asked us if we wanted to come in. She apologized most heartily when she discovered we were not Germans but Americans. Her beloved Americans, she called us, and we were soon tucked away in her best beds, covered with mountainous eider downs which reached halfway to the low ceiling. The next morning, we proceeded on to the old aerodrome where I found the last of our Newports and had it run out and tested. After half an hour's inspection, I found everything right and climbed aboard the little bus and waved my two mechanics goodbye. In 30 minutes, I was over APA Field, having covered the same road which had consumed 4.5 hours by motor car the night before. Up to this time, April 3, 1918, only my squadron, the 94th, commanded by Major John Huffer, one of the old Lafayette flyers, and Captain James Miller's squadron, the 95th, were at the front. Both squadrons had been together at Villeneuve and together had moved to APA. None of the pilots of either squadron had been able to do any fighting at the front, owing to the lack of aeroplane guns. In fact, the pilots of Squadron 95 had not yet been instructed in the use of aeroplane guns, although this squadron had been sent to the front a short time before 94 Squadron had arrived there. We of 94 Squadron, however, had been diverted to the aerial gunnery school at Cazaux for a month early in the year and were now ready to try our luck in actual combat fighting over the lines. But we had no guns on our machines. Then suddenly, guns arrived. All sorts of wonderful new equipment began pouring in. Instruments for the aeroplanes, suits of warm clothing for the pilots, extra spares for the machines. And at the same moment, the foolish virgins of Squadron 95, who hadn't yet learned how to shoot in the air, were sent back to the Cazaux school, while old 94, destined to become the greatest American squadron in France in the number of victories over the enemy, was ordered to vacate the APA aerodrome and move on eastward and north to Toul. On April 10, 1918, we took our departure, flying our Newports over to an old aerodrome east of Toul, which had been vacated by the French for our use. Supplies, beds, mess furniture, oil and gasoline, and all the multitudinous paraphernalia of an aviation camp followed us in lorries and trucks. For a day or two, we had our hands full with settling ourselves in our new quarters and acquainting ourselves with our sector of the map. We were 2 miles east of Toul, one of the most important railroad connections on our side of the front, and a town that the enemy tried almost daily to demolish with aeroplane bombs. We were barely 18 miles from the lines and in a country covered with rolling hills and extensive forests. Nancy lay 15 miles to the east of us, Lunéville 12 miles farther east, and the highway from Toul to Nancy to Lunéville lay parallel to the enemy lines and within easy shelling distance of the Hun guns. But along this highway, one would not have realized that a war was on. East of this point, no efforts had been made at an offensive by either side. Business went on as usual in Lunéville. Children played in the streets and traffic pursued its leisurely way. An occasional German sentry faced a French sentry along the lines from Lunéville to Switzerland at intervals of 100 yards or so, but it was said that these sentries messed together and slept together for the sake of companionship. This unnatural situation was considerably altered later when the Americans came in. The country of the Vosges Mountains was thought to be too rough to permit invasions by either side. North and west of our Toul aerodrome lay Verdun. Verdun, the sine qua non of German success. Under the Verdun Citadel, built in 1863, lay an underground army of 70,000 men. No use to attempt to go around Verdun and leave 70,000 attackers in their rear. Verdun must ever be threatened, even while desperate attacks were being launched against Amiens, Ypres, and the Marne. Consequently, considerable aeroplane activity was indulged in by the pilots of the Huns in this sector, and here the 1st American Fighting Squadron was sent to demonstrate to the world the air ability of American flyers in combat fighting. And 94 got that chance. The squadron at that time was commanded, as I have said, by Major John Huffer. He was one of America's best pilots and finest fellows, but curiously enough, he had been born in France and had never been in America, nor in any English-speaking country, though he has traveled extensively abroad and speaks English like a Harvard man. Major Huffer had served in the ambulance division since the early days of the war, later joining the Foreign Legion with William Thaw, Victor Chapman, and the other American boys. When the American Escadrille was formed, he entered aviation and thus was a veteran war pilot long before America came into the war. When he discovered that our beloved squadron was to receive the distinction of being the first actually to begin fighting for America, the question of a significant and proper squadron insignia became of prime importance to us. We were busy those first days in Toul, painting our machines with the American red, white, and blue, with our individual markings and with the last finishing touches which would prepare them for their first expedition over the lines. Then came the ideas for our insignia. Major Huffer suggested Uncle Sam's stovepipe hat with the stars and stripes for a hatband, and our post surgeon, Lieutenant Walters of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, raised a cheer by his inspiration of the hat in the ring. It was immediately adopted, and the next day designs and drawings were made by Lieutenant John Wentworth of Chicago, which soon culminated in the adoption of the bold challenge painted on the sides of our fighting planes, which several scores of enemy airmen have since been unfortunate enough to dispute. Toul then saw the launching of America's first fighting squadron, and it was from this aerodrome that I won my first 5 victories in the following 30 days. Chapter 3. Our First Sorties. On the evening of April 13th, 1918, we were indeed a happy lot of pilots, for we were reading on our new operations board the first war flight order ever given by an all-American squadron commander to all-American pilots. It stated in simple terms that Captain Peterson, Lieutenant Reed Chambers, and Lieutenant E.V. Rickenbacker would start on a patrol of the lines tomorrow morning at 6 o'clock. Our altitude was to be 16,000 feet. Our patrol was to extend from Pont-à-Mousson to Saint-Mihiel, and we were to return at 8 o'clock. A 2 hours patrol. Captain Peterson was designated as leader of the flight. Picture the map of these French towns, as every pilot in our Squadron 94 had it indelibly pressed into his memory. While flying in the vicinity of enemy territory, it is quite essential that one should know every landmark on the horizon. Every river, every railroad, highway, and village must be as familiar to the airman as are the positions of first, second, and third bases to the home runner. Toul is 18 miles almost directly south of Pont-à-Mousson. Saint-Mihiel is directly west of Pont-à-Mousson, about the same distance. The battle lines ran straight between Pont-à-Mousson and Saint-Mihiel. Then they turned north to run another 18 miles to the edge of Verdun. straight north of Pont-au-Mousson, some 20 miles, Metz is situated. And around Metz, several squadrons of Hun bombing aeroplanes and fighting machines had their lairs on a hilltop, from which they surveyed the lines which we were to patrol this 13th day of April. In short, the sector from Pont-au-Mousson to Saint-Mihiel was fairly alive with air activity when weather conditions permitted the use of aeroplanes at all. This was the beat on which Captain Peterson, Chambers, and I would find ourselves tomorrow at 6. Lieutenant Douglas Campbell and Lieutenant Alan Winslow were directed in the same order to stand by on the alert at the hangar from 6 o'clock until 10 the same morning. This alert was provided for any sudden emergency, such as an enemy bombing raid in our direction or a sudden call for help against an enemy aeroplane within our lines. Immediately after dinner that night, Reed Chambers and I retired with Captain Peterson to his room where we talked over the coming event. The captain gave us some curt directions about the precautions we should take in case of an attack, instructed me particularly that I was to lead the flight if anything happened to him or his motor, and under these circumstances I was to continue our patrol until the time was up. Then he summoned an orderly and gave orders to call all five of us at 5 a.m., advising Reed and me to sleep tight and try not to dream about Fokker aeroplanes. Off he went to bed. We knew very well what we would dream about. Try as I might, I could not get to sleep that night for hours. I thought over everything I had ever read or heard about aeroplane fighting. I imagined the enemies coming at me from every direction. I pictured to myself the various ways I would circumvent them and finally bring them tumbling down to their final crash. At last I dropped off to sleep and continued dreaming the same maneuvers. Just as I was shooting down the last of a good-sized number, the orderly punched my elbow and woke me up. It was 5 o'clock. A wonderful morning greeted us, and the five of us had a merry breakfast. We advised Campbell and Winslow to keep a sharp lookout above the aerodrome that morning, for we intended to stir up the Boches, and undoubtedly there would be droves of them coming over our field for revenge. But upon reaching the field after breakfast, we found that the atmosphere was bad and the mist was so heavy that the ground was completely hidden a short distance away. Captain Peterson sent Chambers and myself up to reconnoiter at 1,500 feet. Away we went. After circling the field two or three times, we noticed Captain Peterson take off and climb up to join us. We continued climbing, and just about the time we had attained the frigid altitude 16,000 feet, I noticed the captain's machine gliding back to the field. Ah, thought I, motor trouble, and he told me last night to carry on in case he dropped out. It is my show now. Come ahead, Chambers. Unsophisticated as I was, I did not know the danger into which I was leading my companion, and as Chambers knew less about the country than I did, he readily followed my lead, and away we flew. We picked up the valley of the Moselle River and proceeded blandly upon our way and would probably have kept on to the Rhine, but for a sudden bark under the tail of Chambers' machine, which announced that we were discovered over German guns. I had been shot up by Archy before and now gloried in the utter contempt I felt for him, but this was Reed's first experience with German anti-aircraft artillery, and as he admitted later, he thought it was all over with him. He sheered in so close to me that we nearly collided. Gradually, we maneuvered out of the zone of fire and eventually became so disdainful of the shell bursts that we proceeded grandly on our way without paying any attention to them. I located Pont-au-Mousson, and from there we set our course for Saint-Mihiel. 4 times we made the round trip between these two towns amid intermittent Archy fire, but without seeing any aeroplanes in the sky. Then I decided we must turn towards home if we were to close our first patrol at the designated time. To my horror, I discovered the whole landscape to the south of us was covered with a dense covering of fog. The whole area was covered, and under the blanket, somewhere in France, was the field upon which we were supposed to land. Land we must in a short half hour, for our fuel would be consumed and we would drop that instant. I began to realize why Captain Peterson had gone back to the field, and I felt cold chills run down my spine as I contemplated the various kinds of mishaps that were in store for Reed and me. There was nothing for it but a dive through the thick fog clouds. I stuck down my nose, entered them, and lost Chambers immediately, and only hoped that he had not come in directly behind me. I flew by compass, all the while watching the needle drop down the altimeter. Cautiously, I flattened out at 1,000 feet, for there are hills in this sector, and some tall trees might show up ahead of me at any instant. Again, I put down her nose and crept nearer the earth. At last, I saw something below me and immediately zoomed up into the mist again. The nervousness of that foggy ride homewards I shall never forget. By the sheerest good luck, I caught a brief glimpse of a Y and a railroad tunnel that somehow seemed familiar to me. I circled back and got another view of it. Imagine my joy when I discovered it was a landmark near Commercy that I had flown over just once before when coming from APA to Toul. I put about and, flying only 100 feet above ground, continued straight to Toul, from which location I easily found the flying field and landed quite perfectly. Captain Peterson came up to me and informed me I was a bloody fool for flying off in a fog, which I knew was a fact, and cheerfully admitted. Then I asked about Reed Chambers, and felt a return of all my previous fear when I learned they had heard nothing from him. With a heavy heart, I got out of my flying clothes and walked over to headquarters to make out my report. I was positive the telephone would ring within a few minutes to inform us that Chambers had crashed and killed himself in the fog. I had barely begun my writing when the telephone did ring. I stood quivering in my shoes while the operations officer answered the call. Then he shouted, "Quick, 2 Boche airplanes are reported over Foug. Send in an alert." But at the same instant, we heard 2 of our machines taking off the field. It was Campbell and Winslow, who had been standing by all the morning for a chance nobody had expected them to get. I started to run towards the hangars, but before I reached the field, a private rushed to me saying, "A German aeroplane has just fallen in flames on our field." It was true. I could see the flames from where I stood. But before I could reach the spot, however, another yell aroused my attention and I turned and saw a second Boche machine falling nose down into a field not 500 yards away. The first had been destroyed by Alan Winslow, who had shot it down in flames within 3 minutes after leaving the field. The second was forced down by Douglas Campbell, and it crashed in the mist before the pilot could discover his proximity to the ground. These were the first 2 enemy aeroplanes brought down by an American squadron, and both were miraculously crashed on the very doorstep of our aerodrome on the first day we had begun operations. Neither of the German pilots was seriously injured. Upon our questioning them as to how they happened to be about in such weather, they informed us that they had been summoned to go up to attack 2 patrolling machines that were being archied between Pont-à-Mousson and Saint-Mihiel. They had followed Chambers and me until they lost us in the fog. Then they tried to find their own way home to their aerodrome near Metz. They discovered our field and came down low thinking it might be their own, when Winslow and Campbell flew up and attacked them at about 500 feet above ground. This was indeed a wonderful opening exhibition for our squadron, and had the stage been set and the scene arranged for it, could not have worked more perfectly. Then it was added to our joy to receive the congratulations and praise of the French inhabitants of Toul, who had endured so many bombing raids from these Boche machines without seeing any Allied planes on the defense of their beloved little city. When they learned that 2 enemy machines had been shot down on the very first day of the arrival of the Americans, their delight knew no bounds. They wrung our hands, kissed us, toasted us in their best Moselle wine, and yelled, "Vive la France! Vive la Americans!" until they were hoarse. We each took a souvenir from the German machines, which were to be the first of our long series of descendus, and the remains of the captured prizes we rolled into Toul, where they remained upon exhibition in the city square until the last vestiges of them disappeared. To our complete joy, we learned that Reed Chambers had landed a short distance away from our drome, and that night he came in to join us. For the next few days, the squadron lived upon its reputation and received the congratulations of our superior officers and the staff with much mock nonchalance. Lieutenants Campbell and Winslow were overwhelmed with telephone calls and cablegrams. From all parts of the United States, congratulations came to them, and quite a number of messages were sent to the 2 victors from England and France. It was particularly fortunate for the squadron that such an extraordinary success should have marked the very first day of our operations, and still more lucky that the enemy machines had crashed in sight of us all. The episode put great confidence into all of us, and we felt we were a match for the whole German Air Force. The date of this first American victory was April 14, 1918. For several days following, bad weather kept us idle on the ground. But on April 18th, an alert was sounded informing us that an enemy plane was seen over Pont-à-Mousson. Reed Chambers and I applied for the job of landing this fellow, and after obtaining permission, we jumped into our machines, which were warmed up and ready, and off we started. I was determined to bring down the next victim for our squadron, and had it all planned out in my mind just how it was to be done. It was a thick day, and the clouds hung about 3,000 feet above ground. We plunged boldly into them and flew straight on. Finally, we got above the clouds and began circling about in wide sweeps, looking everywhere for the bold German. After 30 minutes or more of desperate searching, I decided to drop back below the clouds and see where we really were. Certainly, there were no Boches in this sector, after all. In 10 minutes, I was below the clouds and skimming along the landscape with an eye out for landmarks. Suddenly, I discovered a large city ahead which looked strangely like Nancy, except that it was in exactly the wrong direction. I drew nearer and couldn't believe my eyes when a closer scrutiny proved it was true. I had been trusting to my boasted sense of direction all during this flight and had not even consulted my compass. Consequently, I had turned completely around and had led Chambers in exactly the opposite direction from the spot where the Boche was waiting for us. We had not been within 10 miles of the lines the whole morning. In great disgust, I led the way homewards. Landing my machine, I went over to the office and put in a very brief report to the effect that there were no enemy machines to be seen in our patrol. Quite true as far as I went, but I could not bring myself to state just why there were no Boches that morning. But I learned a very valuable lesson that day, and have never had cause to regret the short discomfiture it gave me. That same day, a hospital unit moved into Toul and settled within a mile of our aerodrome. The nurses were all American girls, and several of us had the good fortune to meet a party of them as we were taking a walk into Toul. After seeing only the coarsest and oldest sorts of French peasant women for so many months, we thought we had never seen anything so beautiful as these first American girls at Toul. We gave them a grand greeting, and as a recompense, all of us were invited to come over for a dance at their mess. In fact, all the boys in our squadrons were invited to come, and we were instructed to give them the message. Having discovered this gold mine ourselves, however, we all mutually and instantly decided we should do nothing of the kind. We walked into town, each man thinking of the girl he would ask for a dance, and what a scoop we would have on the other fellows who would stay at home playing cards at camp. However, when time came, we couldn't keep it to ourselves. We took the whole crowd and introduced them to the girls, and were immediately sorry we had done so. But on the whole, the presence of these girls from back home so near to our field was the second best thing that had happened to us since the war. General Liggett, Commandant of the First Army Corps, and Colonel William Mitchell, commanding the air service, came over to see our group the next day. I was sent up to do some stunting for their entertainment, and upon landing to receive their compliments, I found that I had broken a part of my motor. This little catastrophe put me out of the trench strafing party which our squadron carried out at 4 o'clock that afternoon on the enemy lines just north of Seicheprey. It was a wonderful success, and all the boys came home overjoyed with the scurrying troops on the ground that had been thrown into great confusion by the attack of the aeroplanes. This ground strafing is probably the most exciting sport in aviation, and one that is attended with comparatively little danger to the pilot. The aeroplanes swoop down so swiftly and are so terrifying in the roar of their engines and the streams of bullets issuing forth from two rapid-fire guns that an ordinary soldier always looks for a hole rather than for any weapon of defense. The machine passes overhead so quickly that I imagine no gun can begin to be aimed until we are gone. Only when a steady barrage fire is going up and a pilot happens to pass through its very path does he get injured while upon this work. I have frequently dived down upon a highway filled with marching Germans and put them to flight with one swoop. If they ever fired at me, I never knew it, and never have seen any evidences of a hit through my wing. All these little details seemed very important to me at the time, for it must be remembered that every pilot in our group was fearfully inexperienced and overawed by the mysteries in store for him in the future. War to us was very much of a plunge into an unknown planet. We knew something of the wiles of the enemy and were familiar enough with the dangers that every pilot was so fond of describing. But there remained always that unknown fear of a new menace. Ever constant was the impression that luck might for an instant desert us, and that instant would end the war for us. We often wondered just what new danger would be thwarted by pure luck each time we went out for a patrol into enemy territory. So it was that each experience that came to me in those first days of war flying made a great impression on my mind. I grew more confident each day. Many doubts were removed, more disdain for the enemy came to me, and a growing certainty gradually possessed me that I had fathomed all the possibilities that could threaten me and my aeroplane when over the lines of the enemy. And I always tried to remember every incident that happened, so that in the future I might take advantage of familiar circumstances. I was standing by on the aerodrome on April 23rd when at about noon we received a warning by telephone that an enemy aeroplane had just been sighted between Saint-Mihiel and Pont-à-Mousson flying from west to east. Major Huffer sent me word to get off immediately and find the Boche. No one else was ready, so I set off alone. I took off the field and pulling up her nose, I lifted my little Newport straight upwards as steeply as she would climb, and I set a direct course for Pont-à-Mousson.
The day had been rainy and cloudy, and it had been several days since there had been any activity in the air. In 5 minutes, I picked up the river and the little city of Pont-à-Mousson crowded along its bank.
I was some 8,000 feet up. The French now held Pont-à-Mousson. Enemy artillery had been doing considerable damage to the bridge and buildings, and this now disclosed itself to my eyes. Many roofs were torn off, and the whole town was badly knocked about. I took my eyes away from the ground and began to search the skies for a moving speck. A sudden palpitation of my heart indicated that I did see a speck on the very first glance I shot into Germany. There, at about my own altitude, was the wasp-like edge of an aeroplane coming directly towards me. I began to shiver lest he had seen me first while I was joyriding over Pont-à-Mousson and had thus had time to form a plot of his own before I had formulated any of mine. Both of us continued dead ahead at each other for 20 seconds or so until we arrived almost within shouting distance, when I discovered to my great relief that he wore the blue center cocarde of a Frenchman and his machine was a Spad. We had fortunately neither of us fired a shot. Suddenly, I saw the French pilot zoom up over me and attempt to get on my tail. Whether joking or not, I couldn't permit such a maneuver, so I quickly darted under him and got the best position myself. The Newport can outmaneuver a Spad and has a little faster climb, so the stranger soon found he had his match. But to my amazement, the fellow kept circling about me, continually trying to bring his guns to bear upon me. I began wondering then whether this was some idiot who did not know an ally when he saw one, or was he a real Boche flying over our lines in a captured French machine? The former was evidently the correct solution, for as soon as I came by him again, I turned flat over in front of him and let him have a long look at my American white center cocards on my wings. This performance apparently satisfied my persistent friend, for he soon swerved off and went on home, leaving me to proceed on my mission. This little episode taught me another lesson. Since that day, I have never taken any chances with any aeroplane in my vicinity, whether it was friend or foe. Some friends are better shots than our casual enemies. My real quarry had made his escape during my little tourney with the Frenchman, and I found no game in the sky, though I flew a full 2 hours along the lines. When I returned home, however, I found myself surrounded by the whole force as soon as my Newport stopped rolling on the ground. They fairly overwhelmed me with congratulations for bringing down a Boche who had been seen to fall by one of our artillery batteries. As he fell in the very sector which I was patrolling, they naturally credited me with a victory. It was a pity to undeceive them, but it had to be done. The curious climax to this affair was that we never did discover who shot down that Boche machine. He was never claimed by anyone else. But for my part, I was convinced that I certainly could not have accomplished my first victory without firing a shot or even seeing my enemy. Thus, I had all the fruits of a first victory without having won it. But what was far more important to me, I had learned something more in the art of war flying. I had undoubtedly saved my life by keeping out of the gunsight of a friendly machine. The very next day, I learned another lesson. Again, it was about noon and I was on duty, when an alarm came in that a Boche was flying over Saint-Mihiel. It was a day of low-hanging clouds. I was absolutely determined that day to get my Boche despite every obstacle, so I flew straight into the enemy's lines at about 3,000 feet altitude. At that low height, my machine was a splendid target for Archy, for after the first shot at me, they found exactly the level of the clouds, and they could see I was just under them. Consequently, I knew I was in for a warm time with the shell bursts, and I did some extraordinary dodging across two or three of their batteries. I passed just north of Saint-Mihiel, and within a minute after the Archy began firing at me, I sighted an enemy plane just ahead. I was coming in upon him from the rear, for I had decided it would be a brilliant idea to cross the lines halfway to Verdun and catch the Boche from a quarter that might be unsuspected. It had worked perfectly, though I couldn't understand why he had been so blind as to let the black bursts of shell fire around me pass unnoticed. But still, he sat there with apparently no intention of trying to get away. I began to get nervous with the idea that this was almost too much of a good thing. Was he really a Boche? As this was in reality the first German machine I had ever seen in the air, and I had judged his status from the shape of his planes and fuselage, I thought perhaps I had better actually take a look at his markings before firing and see that he really had a black cross painted on his machine. So I dropped my finger from the trigger of my gun and dived a little closer. Yes, he was Boche, but instead of having a black cross, he wore a black cocarde. It was a black cocarde with white center. This must be something new, as no such markings had ever been reported at our headquarters. However, he was no friend of mine, and I would now proceed to down him. Why did he linger so complacently about my guns? Suddenly, I remembered the often repeated instructions of Major Lefberry about attacking enemy observation machines. Always remember it may be a trap. I hurriedly looked over my shoulder, and just in time, there, coming out of a cloud over my head, was a beautiful black albatross fighting machine that had been hiding about, waiting for me to walk into his trap. I gave one pull to my joystick and zoomed straight upwards on my tail without giving a second thought to my easy victim below me. To my delight, I found that I could not only outclimb my adversary, but I could outmaneuver him while doing so. I got above him after a few seconds and was again pressing my triggers to fire my first shots in the Great War, when again it occurred to me that I had better look again and see that nobody else was sitting farther upstairs watching this little party with a view of joining in while my attention was diverted. I shot a sudden glance over my shoulder. Instantly, I forgot all about bringing down Boche aeroplanes and felt overwhelmed with one immense desire to get home as quickly as possible. Two aeroplanes from Germany were coming head-on at me not 500 yards away. How many more were behind them, I didn't wait to determine. I was convinced that my inexperience and stupidity had led me into a stupendous plot against my person, and I was in for a race for my life. On that homeward trip, I experienced a great variety of feelings. I had been led to believe that German planes were not very good, and that we could fly away from them whenever we wanted to. As I looked back over my shoulder and ascertained that they were gaining upon me in spite of every maneuver that I tried, I felt a queer sort of admiration for their misjudged flying ability, mingled with an unspeakable contempt for the judgment of my instructors who had claimed to know all about German aeroplanes. I climbed, dived, tailspun, circled, and stalled. They beat me at every maneuver and continued to overhaul me. Just when I had begun to despair of ever seeing my learned instructors again, I ran into a cloud. Dimly, I realized I was in a position of advantage for the first moment, so I improved it to the utmost. Halfway in, I reversed directions and began climbing heavenward. After 30 minutes industriously occupied in throwing my pursuers off my tail, I ventured out of concealment and gratefully made my way home. There on the field, two of my dear old comrades were waiting for me to come in. What anxiety they would have suffered if they had known what I had just been through. Hello, Rick. Why the devil didn't you wait for us?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.